As I said, the title of the parsha is Shoftim, Judges. It comes from the plural form of the word Shafat. And I do beg your indulgence again. My voice is kind of scratchy, and my southern drawl doesn't do me any good to start with. It's just kind of scratchy, but please pay as close attention as you can. The word Shafat is understood to mean to judge and govern. In the process of judging and governing, you're going to either be exonerated, vindicated, or you're going to be judged guilty. And this Torah portion is specifically dealing with righteous judgment, which is sorely lacking in the earth. And I submit to you that that is an indictment, a sobering indictment, I might add, to you and I. Because when righteous judgment begins to disappear, the fault lies in the lap of those that call themselves believers. Amen. If you look at the root of the word Shafat, say that with me, Shafat. The root of it is a two-letter root stem, the sheen, the pain root. And it's interesting because this root word is extremely powerful. You see it in such words as the word Shafat, Shoftim. But the word that I'm about to reveal to you now, in my opinion, sets a precedent for how you should understand where righteous judgment originates. Because this two-letter root stem originates in this word in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the first time that it's ever seen, and it's the word shuf. Say that with me. Shuf. If you remember in Genesis chapter 3, you have an encounter that takes place between the serpent, Adam, and Eve. If you don't know what all happened there, go get my book, The Serpent's Seed. It'll open up your eyes. And you'll find that you're going to see some things regarding this shuf that's about to take place in the days ahead. But after that encounter, Yahweh pronounces a very bold and sobering statement. He speaks to the serpent particularly, and he says, I'm going to put enmity between your seed and the seed of the woman. And it shall, talking about her seed, it, and I don't like that because it's kind of gender neutral. If you look in the Hebrew language, it says, he shall bruise your head. Sort of puts it in a little different perspective, right? Speaking to an individual or about an individual, he will bruise your head and thou shalt bruise his heel. This word bruise here is this Hebrew word shuf. And so now you see that there's a defining line that sort of separates between the serpent's seed and the woman's seed and how we're to properly judge circumstances, situations, encounters, words, the aftermath of something that's taken place has its origins in this word shuf. And so there's a connection here between Shoftim, judges, Shafat, an individual who's able to litigate a situation. You have to ask yourself, what does the origin of this word have to do with how I'm supposed to look at a situation and rightly divide between what's right and what's wrong here? It's a good sobering question to ask. In fact, a war occurs over the ultimate control of judgment in the earth. Starts right there. And it becomes something that polarizes the kingdoms, plural. Kingdom of Yahweh and the kingdom of the enemy. And I've got news for you. There's no neutral ground here. You're either in the king's camp or you're in the camp of the enemy. And that sort of, to me, is a very sobering thing because it puts us in a place where we either got to begin to litigate according to Yahweh's word and judge situations accordingly, or you're going to litigate the situation based on what you hear the enemy speaking in your life or what you've been told, your traditions, your personal dogma or doctrine. If you do so other than what Yahweh's word is saying, then you are in a dangerous place. Can you say amen? Amen. That shin pain root also hints at the lip. The lip is indicating in the Torah as a border or a boundary. Isn't that odd? How can I consider this a boundary line or a border? Again, we're talking about righteous judgment, exactly. It has to do with what comes across the boundary line. The words that cross the boundary. And if you happen to listen to Rico Cortez teaching last week, it was about encroaching. Do you know that if you trespass across another boundary, that you're guilty of encroaching? And is that odd? Because Yahweh's now turning around and using what comes out of our mouth and our own boundary line that He's established in us, our mouth, our heart, our tongues, to tell us that if we're not careful, we're guilty of trespassing. And if you're guilty of trespassing, then you're not able to judge circumstances and situations rightly. Aren't we wanting to judge, to rightly divide the word of truth? Aren't we? It seems to me that we're in a situation where we need to be exonerated. If I want to go before the king, and I've been, last night was at the hospital in the emergency room, and we're praying about a situation that was just horrific. It was Manuel and Ada were again at the hospital last night. And when you begin to pray, and you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that there's far more in the natural that are against what you're declaring with your mouth, the medical community has a different mindset when it comes to judging your physical condition, especially when the presence of disease is there. And in particular, when they want to cultivate fear and begin to propagate that fear and cause you to begin then to entertain what they're trying to cause you to grasp. Fear. You're either going to say what Yahweh's word says, or you're going to say what they're saying. Now again, there's no middle ground. You've got to be able to righteously make a decision, a judgment in a case like that, because life and death is in the power of the tongue. And we're going to look at that verse. And we're going to be, I hope as we look at it, we're going to understand that we've got to be more careful with what we say and how we say it in the days in front of us than we have in the past. Because words are powerful. Okay? That two-letter root stem indicates that your words carry the power to shoof, to bruise, to crush, to gain control over. Now that's okay if you're dealing with an enemy of Yahweh's. But if you're dealing with another individual, where do we find that we have the right to bruise and crush and wound? Think about it. You need to be careful. Your words have the ability to litigate. Your words have the ability to cause you to be vindicated in the courtroom of creation, or it also has the ability to punish you. And what I found is that our words, what comes out of our mouth, listen to me carefully here, I want you to listen, because if you speak words of judgment over another individual or over a situation, you're the one who's judged first by your own words. I don't know if that made sense to you. Did you understand what I just said? The words that come out of my mouth when I speak them regarding another person or another person's situation automatically put me in a position of being judged by my own words. And I'll show you that. It's called the law of sowing and reaping. In the world, we would say what goes around comes around. Does that make sense to you? I just quoted a verse to you, Proverbs 18:21, and I want you to look at it because I'm going to show you where you may have seen it before, but probably you're going to see something in this verse that you might not have seen before. Proverbs 18:21 says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue." Have you ever heard that before?
Yes.
It goes on to say, those people that love it, what? Love the power that the tongue has, are going to eat the fruit of it. Now, if you just read that in the King James English, it has sort of a negative connotation to it, right? And that's the way you take it. Those that love the power of the tongue are going to eat the fruit of it. Well, my goodness, I love the power of the tongue when it comes to setting the captives free. And so I want to eat the fruit of liberty. I love the power of the tongue when it comes to setting free those that have been sick and diseased. And so the fruit of that is health and life. Does that make sense? Can you see the distinction between the two? And that word power there is interesting because it's not the word power that we are accustomed to see. It just happens to be the word yad. Say it with me, yad. It's the Hebrew word for hand. Death and and life are in the hand of the tongue. Well, that word Yad in Scripture just so happens that it's part of the name of the Creator. Yad-Heh, Yod-Heh, Yud-Heh. It's part of His name, Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh. And that word Yad literally indicates I have authority and power. If it's in my hand, I'm in control. And so if I have the hand of the tongue, if the word of Yahweh is in the hand of the tongue, then I have control of my situation, not sickness, not disease, not the enemy. When did we begin to relinquish that control? Come on, talk to me now. All my life, I've been a student of people. And it's easy to see how sometimes people can get a bully mentality. Now, how many of you have ever seen anybody bullied or been on the receiving end of bullying? Come on. It's okay to raise your hand. I'm not going to bully you. You don't have to, but I'm going to come see you afterwards. Raise your hand. I told you to do it. Oh, excuse me. See, it's bullying tactics. But what happens if the bully can intimidate you, it gets in your space, then all of a sudden you've relinquished. He hasn't controlled you. He hasn't gained control until you relinquish it. The enemy has no power over you unless you relinquish that power. That's why we're admonished to be careful about the words that we say and words that we put inside here, and to begin to remember that Yahweh's word is a sharp two-edged sword. It cuts, as we would say back home, two ways, coming and going. Actually, it cuts three ways, deep, wide, and continuous. His word's powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. And the interesting thing is it pierces so deeply inside the man, and science to this day can't fathom it. The scripture says it's able to separate between the spirit and the soul of the man. Nothing else in creation can do that. Yahweh's word can. It also says that Yahweh's word gets down into the bones of a man. Hallelujah. How many of you remember when there was a man that died in a battle, and they took him, and they had to bury him kind of quickly, and so they took him and threw him in the grave. It just so happened there was another person in that grave, and his name was Elisha. And this man had been dead, because he'd been dead long enough until they referred to it as bones. So it had evidently been down there deteriorating for quite some time. They took this man's body, threw it into this grave, and as soon as it touched the bones of Elisha, he leapt up and was made alive again. What was that? How could that happen? How could that happen? It was because Elisha had a double portion of the anointing that was on Elisha, and that double portion of anointing, I believe, was the resonating word of Yahweh inside of him that had so much power that it was still in what they thought were dead bones. Which is a prophetic indicator that this group of bones that are mentioned there in Ezekiel chapter 37 that have been scattered and distorted to all the four corners of the world, they may look as if they're dead bones, but there's something resonating on the inside of these dead bones that's going to cause us to begin to stand up and begin to come together bone to its bone in its proper place, and the anointing of Yahweh is going to begin to fall on us, and we're going to stand up and form the body of Messiah in the earth and become a force, listen to this carefully, a force that has to be reckoned with. We're not going to go out of here whimpering. If you study what modern church theology teaches, what modern church eschatological prophetic declarations are doing. Now, I'm not talking about just the rapture, but you'll find it ensconced within the rapture doctrine. They teach that the church is going to leave out of here beaten down, weak and timid, and just by the very skin of their teeth be snatched out of here before it gets even worse. Talk about painting a bleak picture. But that's not what Yahweh's word teaches. In fact, there are some instances of rapture taking place. And if you want to see that, it's in Genesis chapter 6. And it was the ungodly that were taken out of the earth and the righteous were left. Woo. And so if the enemy wants to get up in your face and tell you that you're going to be raptured out, you need to point to his future and tell him, excuse me, dude, you're going before I am. Are you hearing me? That's what's got to change in us. It's got to be our declaration. It's got to be what we begin to say that changes how we see things. You can look at it and it's one way, and it's not going to change until you speak it, the word to it, and begin to make it change. Amen. That's what Yahweh's word's about. It's about causing change. How many of you want change?
Yes.
Oh, you're really enthusiastic, I can tell. That's why you haven't got it. Well, you just don't understand us. We're not that temperamental and emotional. I got news for you. When you begin to get persecuted and squeezed, and the enemy begins to cause you to be hearing the words fatal and terminal, and I'm finished with you, then you're going to get emotional. Hello? I would suggest you need to start practicing now, because when you get in the middle of a crisis situation, what you put in moments of ease is going to be what comes out when you get squeezed. You believe that? You believe that? How many of you have been squeezed lately? Yeah, we should stay back home, take a deep breath, do that with me. You smell that? Yeah, now you know what's coming out. You know what's been put inside of you, amen? Is it the sweet smelling aroma of Yahweh's word that's able to dispel the powers of darkness? If it is, my goodness, then there's change on the way. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, change is on the way. I want you to look at this word in Proverbs 18:21. I want you to be careful, because it's talking about death and life and the power of the tongue. This one, right? Stick your tongue out. I want you to look at it. It's okay. Look. Death and life and the power of the tongue. What is the Hebrew word for tongue? Lashon. Do you know what that word means? Did you know that the word, the very root, the stem of that word means slanderer? Do you know what a slanderer is? I have a definition here for you in case you don't. A slanderer is one that utters lies that cause an unfavorable opinion. Look at it. Your tongue's been slandering you. Your tongue's been slandering you, and guess what? You put up with that. It's time you stopped it. How can I stop it? It's my tongue. It just does what it wants to do. I can't help it. I just couldn't control myself. You're a liar. I hear that all the time. I'm sorry. I just couldn't control myself. Yes, you can. If you can't do it from the natural, from the spirit side, it's just okay. I'm not going to say that. Because it drops in here first. Boy, I just didn't understand it. Boy, I shut my mouth off before I had a chance to think about it. No, you didn't. What you've got to learn to do is to get control. And if you can control this little member of the body, you know, that's one thing that concerns me, because it's described as the smallest member of the body. And yet it's the one that sets on fire the course of nature and causes everything around you to literally be in a blaze on a continuous basis. And it's this thing right here. Amen. Amen. Your tongue's been slandering you. Your tongue's been telling you about your particular situation, and honestly, you believe it. How can you say that? You're not listening to me. Well, you are. You have the situation that you have because you've let your tongue get away with it all this time. Do you want to change that?
Yes.
Well, there's a remedy for you. Say amen.
Amen.
In fact, our tongues judge other people real quickly. And I'll be honest with you, I'm one of those individuals that's really quick. And I remember people saying all the time, don't judge unless you be judged. And you can get that, in particular when the Torah police are out. Okay? And so I was wanting you to look with me in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 and 2. It says, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. In other words, how you judge other people is going to determine how you're judged. Well, I'm one of those individuals that believe in capital punishment. Hello?
Yes, yes.
And I've hanged a lot of folks with my judgment. And I wonder sometimes if I'm like a cat, because I've got more than nine lives, because I've used my tongue to hang a few people. And I know I'm not by myself. But the thing about it here, it goes on to say, with the measure you meet, and this is Elizabethan English, and I'm going to try and break it down for you. The measure that you meet, it will be measured back to you. Now, I had it here, note the words in bold type, but the individual that took care of my PowerPoint left the bold type out. What should be in bold type here is, and with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. If you knew that was going to happen instantaneously, then you would be a little bit slower in judging other people. Hello?
Yeah.
Are you following?
Yes.
What does this have to do with this Torah portion, Shoftim? Well, isn't it talking about judging here? We're talking about righteous judges. And honestly, as a group of people, in particular, when we're facing national elections, this is a hotbed topic. Because we're about to set over us people in local and state and national elections that are going to be judging the people. And you hear people all over. You can go anywhere and you can get into some sort of a discussion about these particular individuals that are going to be sent into places of judgment. And I'm thinking to myself, wouldn't it be a novel idea if we would start setting the proper judge up here first? And then if I start setting up the proper judge here in my own life and in my own house, that would translate over to the local congregations. And then the local congregations would begin to rightly judge themselves. And it would transform the local community and the local county and the state. And all of a sudden, those that call themselves believers would have control again. Are you following?
Yes.
Look at this next verse. Mark chapter 4, verse 24. It's the parable of the sower. Anybody ever read that? One of my favorite passages, because Yahweh says that everything in the kingdom is based on the principle of sowing and reaping. Now we're talking about judgment, right? And so if I'm judging someone else, then I'm sowing into their life. And if Yahweh says the measure that I meet, in other words, how I sow into your life, will be directly proportionate to how I reap or what's measured back to me. Does that make sense? And so if that's the case, Mark chapter 4, verse 24 now says something else. It starts talking about hearing. It says, take heed or pay attention. Turn to your neighbor's elbow and say, pay attention. Pay attention. Take heed to what you hear. Oh, wait a second. Now it kind of turns around and changes things just a little bit, because I'm talking in the first person to begin with about me judging you. And now it swaps in and it's you on the receiving end of my words of judgment. And Yahweh's telling you that everything's in the kingdom is based on this principle of sowing and reaping. Someone saying something and how you hear it. He goes on to say, pay attention to how you hear it. Look at this. For with the measure you meet, it shall be measured to you, and unto you that hear shall more be given. Did you notice that's the same statement that was mentioned in Matthew chapter 7 regarding judgment? How many of you feel like that you've been wrongly judged on occasion? Hello? Wow, isn't that odd? Now thank you. Raise the hands again. How many of you believe? Now keep your hands up. You believe you've been wrongly judged. Well, if that's the case and you've been wrongly judged, you've been reaping something. Do you think you were wrongly judged because you wrongly judged someone else? Oh, I stepped on an ingrown toenail. You see what I'm saying? That's the law of sowing and reaping. If you've been wrongly judged, it's highly probable that you've been guilty of wrongly judging other individuals. I thought, wow, isn't that amazing? Now, we know that there are times, just like Yeshua was wrongly judged. And if you happen to stand along the same level that he does, then my goodness, bless your darling heart, you're being judged because of the word of Yahweh on the inside of you. And the word is what's going to cause you to be judged. And I'm thinking, this ought to begin to cause us to change how we speak about other people and about these situations around us. And I'll be honest with you, I'm quick-witted. And all of my life, my tongue has been one of my major tools. I was gifted with that. But I used it wrong. I used it to injure. I used it to hurt. I used it to my advantage. And guess what? I've been on the receiving end of it. Hello? But what God was trying to teach us now is how to change things in the kingdom. How many of you want to do that? What it sounds to me like as I begin to look at this is that we're being warned about measuring first what we hear. Because if someone's speaking unrighteous things against you, you have the right to refuse to entertain that. But how many of you have listened to the words that other people have spoken to you? How many people have heard things that have been grandfathered down regarding who you are, passed on to you? How many of you have listened to the enemy whisper things in your ears, unrighteously, erroneously judging you? And you just sat back and received it. Well, I guess it must be true. Oh my goodness. I am probably exactly what that person said that I am. And you begin to throw a pity party. And before you know it, you're so overwrought and emotional about what's going on around you that you can't think straight. And then you begin to find your situation gets worse. The emotional, spiritual atmosphere is like that dark cloud hanging over you. And then all of a sudden, someone else that comes in that's got some word in them can begin to speak into your life, or you can put on a tape or a CD that's got some praise and worship in it, and you can begin to feel something on the inside of you. And I don't know if you've ever noticed that, but Yahweh's word can change the spiritual atmosphere within just a few seconds. Have you ever noticed that? I do a lot of counseling, and I found that when you begin to speak Yahweh's word in the situation instead of what the situation looks like or what other people are saying about the situation, and if you choose to believe Yahweh's word, all of a sudden the spiritual atmosphere changes and people begin to get kind of excited again. We're back into the game. We begin to feel the presence of Yahweh. We begin to know that we're going to live and not die. Because that word there, measure, even in the Greek language, is important. It's a Greek word that indicates a rule or a standard of measure regarding judgment. And I have to ask you, exactly what is your measuring device? What are you using to measure what you hear with? What are you using to measure what comes across the boundary lines? Listen to me. If you cross this boundary line here, you've just got into my territory. Hello? We need to start, you're in my space. If you start speaking things across this boundary line, you just got into my space. You just got into Yahweh's space. And when you begin to speak words that are countermanding the promises of Yahweh, then you're guilty of intruding into some places that you've got no business, and you start saying things contrary to Yahweh's words, you begin to vex His spirit. You know what happens when you vex the spirit of Yahweh? What does He say about that? He says, if you vex my spirit, then I, not the enemy, I got my hands full with this, the enemy. How about you? I'm going to have to have somebody to follow me with a camera because I'm coming out there. Okay? He says, if you vex my spirit, I will make war against you. Oh, my goodness. You thought you had it horrible to start with. If Yahweh begins to make war against you, you've lost. And so that's why we've got to start changing things. We've got to understand. We've got to get a new measuring device. A number of years ago, I was asked to put in a small closet a water heater. And they sent me in to build a little cabinet for this water heater to sit on. And I have a little 2-foot level, and I've got that thing in there. I have a pretty good eye, and I was looking at it, and said, man, it just doesn't look right. And I finished building the cabinet. I built the frame and put the thing up on top of it. And I look at it. It just doesn't look right. But this level says it's right. The level says it's right. But my eye, I back off. And, you know, it's in this kind of a confined area. Maybe it's, you know, something's affecting or distorting my vision some way. But I, you know, I've got a history here. I've got a good eye. I can see that thing. But the level said it was right. Another guy that was my boss come by and walked past that thing and comes back and does a double take and said, son, what you do, that thing's off. I said, the devil said it was right. Yeah. And what have you been saying? your level's right. I don't turn your neighbor to my level's always right. You know what I did? I took that level and I went outside, got another level, and got to looking, it was about a bubble off. Turn to your neighbor, tell him you're a bubble and a half off. Well, see, I set my confidence in this level. And even though I could look at it from the natural, see, something's wrong. And honestly, you've been doing the same thing. You can look at your situation and you know beyond a shadow of a doubt, something just don't look right here. I'm supposed to be a believer. I'm a son of the Most High. I'm filled with His Word. Something's not right in my situation. But this level says it's right. And you know what the level is? The level is what's been coming out of your mouth and what you've been listening to. So you're going to have to check that level against one that has never failed. Your measuring device, listen to me, your measuring device is going to be the winner in that struggle that's taking place inside here. It's easy to say the right things when everything's going good. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I can praise Him. Hallelujah. You know, I've seen that the mountaintop is always crowded with people that are just wanting to praise. You know, think about that. Just want to praise Him. We're on top of the mountain. You get in the middle of a valley, you can't find anybody to praise. Is it just me or is my eye wrong? Are you serious? It's in the valley that we need to learn how to pray. Everybody thinks that we're going to spend the time on the mountain, but if you look on the mountain, at the mountain, you've got a valley on both sides of it. So it seems a reasonable deduction tells me that I'm going to spend more time in the valley than I am on top of the mountain. And so you better learn how to praise Yahweh in the midst of the valley. If you start doing that, the length of time, the duration of time that you spend in the valley is probably going to change. Some of you have been wondering why you've been doing a merry-go-round in your situation. Round and round and round, doing the same thing, year after year. No change is taking place. Poor old pitiful me. Everybody's been looking at me and they see that this stuff has just been going on. Come on. The reason that you're there is because you haven't begun to speak to that situation. Speak to your own mountain. Stop speaking to everybody else's. How come you're not amen? I won't speak to your mountain. Just give us a chance to give some tithe and offer. Your mountain's going to change. See, this is what Yahweh's trying to teach us. If you want to understand the measuring device, it doesn't change. It's biblical law. Biblical law does not change. Yahweh's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I shared that with my friend last night. I said, Yahweh doesn't change. I want you to understand something. I don't care what your situation is. You're not the one guaranteeing it. You're not the one that's guaranteeing the situation. You're not the one that's guaranteeing the word that's being spoke over. If you will speak Yahweh's word to that, and this is where we kind of get a little bit timid. What if I do it and it doesn't work? Who cares? You do your job to speak Yahweh's word to it and let Him. And I did just that. I said, you know, you said put me in remembrance of your word. Have you ever read that in Isaiah? Put me in remembrance of your word. It says, come, let's plead together. You know how you've interpreted that scripture? Your pleading has been this. Oh, God, if you help me, you know, I'm going down. It's the third time. That's your pleading. Hello? But that word plead in the Hebrew language is the word litigate. He says, come into the courtroom of creation, bring your legal documents, put me in remembrance of your word, and I will vindicate you. Yeah. Now, but usually, it's all about adhering to His word or not, and it's a relationship issue. If you're not speaking His word, you've got relationship issues. That sheen pay root that we saw in the word shafat, sheen pay tet. If you take them and rearrange them, you can make it spell the word sheen tet pay shatat. Now listen to this, because this is connecting us with the same three letters. The letters keep their individual meaning. You can put them any way you want, but they still retain their original meaning. And so this word shatat is a Hebrew word that indicates to cleanse and conquer, to overflow. And if you look at that, you can understand righteous judgment. And hear me well. Some of us are in the circumstances that we're in because we made mistakes. And I'll just be the first one to tell you, I've made a few mistakes. Okay? And I've been in the places where I've been because I made mistakes. And you get there and you start beating yourself up. Well, my goodness, I made a terrible mistake. You know, you can remedy that pretty quickly. You can remedy that by speaking Yahweh's word and begin to change the situation by righteously judging it. Okay, Father, I've sinned. I've come short of your glory, your will in this particular situation. I am asking you to forgive me. And then you begin to make changes. You begin to implement that. Righteous judgment is a form of cleansing and purging in those situations when you've made some mistakes. But we don't like admitting that we're the ones that's made a mistake, and our mistake's what's got us where we're at right now. I like to blame other people. It's just plain simple. It's my wife's fault. If she hadn't married me, it's my children's fault. If I didn't have these children, if I didn't have this life, if they didn't tax me to no end, if it wasn't for a certain young lady that was constantly provoking me beyond my endurance level, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. Are y'all listening to me here? Surely none of you are guilty of this, and I don't mind you laughing at me if it helps you to do the self-examination necessary to get yourself out of the rut that you're in. You're going to have to get yourself up by the bootstraps and begin to encourage yourself in Yahweh's word so that you can change your situation. Hell is coming this direction like a runaway locomotive. Society as you know it is going to change in just a few more months. The economic climate, the political climate, the social climate, the status that you've been enjoying is going to be changing. Oh, he's prophesying. My goodness, we're not the cutting edge. No, that's what Yahweh's word says.
Yes.
We're living in a season when it's about to change. And I've got news for you. You're going to remain constant and stable because of Yahweh's word. He says there's a whole lot of shaking coming. Jerry Lee Lewis didn't coin that. There's a lot of shaking that's coming. Are y'all with me? And it says, those that can't be shaken are what's going to remain. Turn to your neighbor and ask him, are you going to be shaken off? Well, they let you know real quick, didn't they? Well, they were at courtyard. Nobody wants to talk about these things because it's not pleasant being in hard times. It's not pleasant being between that rock and hard place. It's not pleasant when you've been on the sick bed and the doctors are telling you there's no hope for you. It's not pleasant when you've had a terminal declaration out of the mouth of a man that should know what he's saying. Amen. When you look around you and you hear all of these political pundits telling us, oh, if you vote for Trump, the world's coming to an end. If you vote for Hillary Clinton, they're coming to an end quicker. And then you've got to make the choice. Oh, I've got to make the better or the worst of the two bad choices or the two good choices. And you're thinking about these leaders that you're putting over, having given oversight in your life, and you think, oh my goodness, wait a minute. They don't put my pants on in the morning. If she gets in, she's not changing my house tomorrow. If he gets in, I'm still going to work the following day unless the hell breaks loose within that in the next few hours. And so something else is responsible for the situation that I'm in. I wonder who it is. I wonder why I've been hangdog like this all my life. I wonder why I've been deep down depressed and worried and frustrated. I wonder where that's coming from. I just don't understand why I look at my present situation and I just can't figure out how to get out of it. Somebody's responsible for this. You know, I've been doing a lot of detective work, and I've been looking at this, and I'm ferreting out all those that have input in my life, and I've yet to come to a proper conclusion. Somebody's responsible for what's going on here. Somebody's got to be exposed. We're cleaning house. I've got news for you as soon as we find it out. Mm-hmm. And that conversation is right in front of the mirror. It's me and you, boy. It's me and you. This is what God was trying to teach us here. If we remove source, which is Torah, then we replace Yahweh's divine mercy and Yahweh's judgment with a perverted human form of it. And it's for this reason, if you read this Torah portion, it immediately goes into a discourse regarding idolatry. Did y'all read that? It sort of looked out of place, didn't it? And it starts talking about idolatry and taking and erecting, and that's a kind of a poem for those who didn't catch it. Setting up right poles called Asherah poles around the altars that you would build. And I thought, wait just a second. Did you hear that? What is an altar? All these years I spent with it, nobody can answer that. An altar is a place that you come in, is actually the seat of your worship, isn't it? And so he's telling, right there, the seat of the place where you worship. Don't bring in these idolatrous practices. And immediately when you read that, the first thing that you can think of is these handmade images and forms and stuff of that, like that. But it's more than just that. It's more than just that. We're going to look at it. It's talking to us about, in my opinion, the words that comes out of our mouth. Let's look at that. Deuteronomy 16:21. Are y'all enjoying yourself?
Yes.
Thou shalt not plant thee a grove of any trees near unto the altar of Yahweh your Elohim, which thou shalt make thee. That word there for grove is that word Asherah, and it's translated as idol worship. And we immediately associate it with totem poles, and I don't mind throwing out Christmas trees because they're a form of an Asherah pole. Are you hearing me? But if you understand what that Asherah pole literally represents, it's a phallic symbol. And I'm going to be as delicate as I can. It literally represents the male deity and his ability to procreate. So it's you're literally coming to the place of worship to receive the seed from this idolatrous object. Does that make sense? Remember, seed and word are synonyms. Don't you forget that. Don't you never tell them. They're synonymous. This word Asherah, and I want to show you something, because we're all guilty of putting these poles, these Asherah poles, right in the middle of where we're worshiping. Not me. Well, then you've not been worshiping. Because you've had poles. You've had the Asherah poles there. Okay? This word Asherah comes from the root of Strong's number 833. It's the word Ashar, or Asher, which means to go straight, to walk, to make progress, that which is upright or erect. It happens to be the root stem of the word for Israel, Yesha'el, that's the root stem. And the word Israel means those who walk upright before Yahweh, okay? And by the way, I threw in Proverbs 14:12 for you. There is a way that seems right to a man, okay? And that's why we put these Asherah poles right in the place of our worship, because it seems right to us. Well, you know, he knows our heart. And you know, I've been called to judge situations. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 says, what? You've got squabbles in the congregation and you're not dealing with them. Don't you understand that you're going to be judging angels, and yet you have difficulty judging a smaller matter in the local congregation? And so, yes, I know I'm called to judge. And so that's why I spend the majority of my time judging other folks. Because I have that call. Are you with me? And then I find myself constantly having to deal with a boomerang situation in my life. I'm probably the way it comes back. It's like the dog that you feed constantly around your backyard that belongs to the neighbor. You can't figure out why your neighbor's dog's there, but you're the one that feeds it. There is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is the ways of death. And that word right there is the word yeshar. Interesting, isn't it? Did you know that the rabbis teach that to appoint an unrighteous judge or an unrighteous leader is the same or akin to planting an Asherah pole right by your place of worship? I'll bet you'll go out and vote tomorrow. Hello? Are you hearing me? This is pretty important. But it's far more than just going to vote for someone that's in an election. This is a personal indictment here, because like it or not, you're charged with judging your particular situation. And if I'm putting you in a place to judge my home, if I've been put in a place to judge my home, and I'm not judging it righteously, then what I've just done, I've just brought in idolatry into the place of worship. No wonder your house has a curse on it. Father, forgive us. We need to be praying that, Father. We need you to show us where these things are hidden, how we can get them excised out of the house. Are you following me? That word Asherah then becomes a direct counterfeit. It's a flaunting, a form of rebellion when you just literally flaunt something in the face of Yahweh. And you know it's related to Baal worship. But what I want you to understand is it's literally related to your own personal or private interpretation. And you've got so enamored with your own private opinions and interpretation in your traditions until that became the straight path rather than Yahweh's word. And I thought, isn't that odd? Because Matthew chapter 7, 13 and 14 warns us about the straight gate and the narrow gate. Have you ever noticed? It's just like driving through downtown Salem in the middle of traffic when people are trying to go home. You've got the little small entrance ways and you have all of the traffic there. It's kind of like believers. We're just all concrete. Nobody wants to go to the little small out of the way place. Everybody comes to us right there. And I'm thinking, do you think maybe we have a herd mentality? And what happens is that we've allowed the things that we've been seeing continue on. We've developed a herd mentality. As long as everybody's there with us, it must not be that bad. Father, it seems to me that Yahweh's instilling in Israel here an understanding about having or taking charge over their own words so that they can govern their own walk before they attempt to use those same words as a means of governing the lives of others. The law of sowing and reaping, if you will. Now tell me the truth. How many of you are kind of fond of looking at other people's lives and saying, yeah, you know, there's something wrong with that? Yeah. You know, I get pregnant with us all the time. But then I just kind of felt like I heard from the Lord about so-and-so in the congregation. And I just wanted to share that prayer request. Come on now. You think maybe this is what Yahweh's trying to talk to us about a little bit further? It stops talking about litigating, judging properly, and makes another transition. And to me, when I'm looking at the Torah portions and these things happen, it's kind of like going down a street and all of a sudden there's a red light. Boom, I gotta stop. Because then it starts talking about writing your own Torah. And it specifically begins to address the king and his responsibility. And it says that. It says, Vekatav lo et mishnah ha-Torah. He's required to write his own Torah. And by the way, you are also required to write your own Torah. And like it or not, you are. You may be making some bad copies, but you're writing one. And you can call it the Torah of Yahweh if you want. But I've got news for you. Based on the demonstration of our lives, there's some scribal errors here. I'll be the first one to say, you've got problems. Are you with me? I want you to look at this word where it says to write here. It's the word katab. Say that with me, katab. And it means to inscribe. It means to etch, to score something with a mark, to register it, to record it. And yet it also indicates to continue writing. But there's something about the Hebrew here that indicates that it's more than just writing on the surface of something. This word, katab, indicates that the writing is going in something. The writing, the letters are being etched inside. You follow me? Now look at the word for Mishnah. The Mishnah Torah, scroll of the Torah. It comes from the root of the word Shanah. And that word Shanah means second. It means to repeat. It means to do something again, to change, to alter, to disguise oneself. I want you to get this, okay? Mishnah. Mishnah. You have the mem prefix to the front of it. Y'all with me still? You okay? But if you're not okay, it's evident you've got some issues to deal with. The Hebrew letter M or mem indicates the birthing place, the womb, or the place of origin, okay? And then you have the aleph and tav that's appended to it. We understand that when you've got the aleph and tav connected by a hyphen, that it's indicating what's being written here is talking about the Messiah, okay? So it seems to me that the king is being told to let the writing, even though he's responsible for it, he's being told, let that writing that you're going to do and a subsequent reading of what you're writing, in other words, what you write, you're charged with reading. That means you examine it to make sure that you wrote it properly. And you follow. The loudest message that you will ever leave, your legacy, is a living Torah. And so you're writing the Torah as we speak. And so Yahweh's trying to tell you, like he's telling this king, whoa, stop for a second. You write a little bit, then you go back and look and make sure there's no scribal errors. Throughout your daily walk, you need to stop and do a gut check and make sure that there are no scribal errors that you've been writing and scribing, not just in your life, but in the life of the other individuals around you. You see that? It goes on to say, if he allows it, the writing and subsequent reading of the book of the Torah will make him a representation of Messiah in the earth, and therefore he's charged with judging and ruling in the place of Messiah. And he's to allow the Torah as he writes it and later reads it to begin to alter and or change him into the image of Messiah as the ruler in the earth. You should be asking Yahweh, change me. Change me. Instead, someone or something else is changing you. We're being conformed in someone's image. That's a declaration that was made in Genesis chapter 1 when Yahweh says, let us make man in our image and our likeness. After the fall of Adam, man continued to be made in the image of the Adam who had a carnal, perverse nature. You're either going to be conformed into the image of that carnal, perverse nature, or you're going to be changed into the image of Yahweh. This is your choice. That's why we have problems with our flesh. Say amen. As he writes in the scroll and continues to read it, he becomes the tablet. The rabbis say, listen to me carefully, the rabbis say when they read that particular part of the Parsha, that it's actually saying that he's supposed to write two Torahs. One that he leaves in a sacred, safe place, and the other that he must carry with him throughout his daily observations, his daily duties, so that he can turn to that Torah in the course of his ordinary duties so that he can righteously judge whatever he's approaching. He's supposed to have two Torahs. But that's not what's literally being said here in the Hebrew language. What's actually being said here, in my opinion, is that as he writes in a scroll and continues to read it, he then becomes the tablet. He becomes the source that's now being etched and scored with the mark. The word of Yahweh is now being written inside him, and he becomes the second copy. He becomes the repetition. He becomes the repeated copy. He becomes the written book, just like the one that the Kohanim have. Can I ask you a question? What book are you writing? Are you writing the Torah? Does the Torah scroll you have look like the one that's in the face of the high priest? You know, that's a good question to be asking. Because if it doesn't, then what we've been writing is suspect. And I may not have access to the one that you've been writing with your hand, but I'm looking at you, and you're looking at me. And it's evident by that examination that there's some scribal error somewhere. Either I'm seeing it wrong, or I'm hearing it wrong, or we've written it wrong. We've got to make some changes. Write the Torah. Write the book. The word book there is the word sefer. And you're familiar with it. It's a word that means book, scroll, to count, to number, to rehearse, to declare. It indicates that they're responsible for reiterating, again, the source of Yahweh's word. Now here's where it gets interesting. Can y'all hold on a little longer? You're too tired. Yeah. Yahweh doesn't mince words, okay? I want you to look at that word for book there. It's the word safer. It has that sheen, pain, resh root. We've been talking about sheen, pain, right? But it's also related to the Zani pain resh. And I saw that, the word safer, the word safar, which is where we get shofar. Y'all see it? And then when I saw it, I was reminded of the word zephyr. Zephyr, shepherd, safer. If you're not careful, if you don't listen real closely, you'll miss the little nuances that make it a little bit different. But they're related one to another. And so when they're related like that, then you've got to go back and ask, well, what does that word zephyr, which is the root of the Hebrew word for frog, zephyrdia. Anybody ever heard that word? The second plague that fell on the children of Israel and Egypt? The word zephyrdia, look at it, it's spelled Zadi Pei Resh. See that? There's your three-letter root. But then it has on the end, it has a Dalet Ayin. The Dalet Ayin is a Hebrew word that means knowledge. The Zadi Pei Resh root there, hence it going back to lead, to depart. And so what you find here is that the reason Yahweh's judging this quote-unquote fraud deity that Egypt was worshiping was because it was causing the children of Israel to depart from knowledge. What knowledge? The knowledge of Torah. Why? Because Joseph had taught the children of Israel. Joseph went down into Egypt, left a legacy of teaching the Torah, and it was that generation that raised up a Pharaoh that did not know Joseph. Oh, I understand now. He didn't know Joseph. Why? Because he had departed from the Torah. You see that? So Yahweh had to deal with these frogs. And I thought, isn't that interesting? Because in the last days, there's unclean spirits that's going to be released to go out through the land. And it says that they are spirits of frogs. You realize what that's telling you? You're going to have to deal with a plague of frogs. Not literal, the toad frogs or whatever that we're talking about now. As much as it is those lying spirits that are going into the four corners of the world to deceive people, to get you to depart from the knowledge of Yahweh. Wow. That's interesting. This frog goddess was called Hehet. And it's interesting because she was considered the goddess of childbirth and the goddess of fertility. She attended every birth, according to their legends, of the Egyptians. And guess what? She had literal priestesses that was involved in her religious rites, and they were trained as midwives. Now I want you to think about that. Because when I saw it, I was instantly reminded of when Pharaoh went to the midwives of Israel. Isn't that interesting? You have a juxtaposition here of the midwives of Israel and the midwives of this frog goddess. And Yahweh's going to have to deal with both of them. And they were there to attend to every birth. You have to ask yourself, are they still in existence today? I submit to you that the frog gods are still here because every word, every seed that comes out of your mouth is just as surely as if you were on a birthing stool. You're releasing seed. If you're listening to it, you're receiving seed. And so the frog gods are sitting right there in the middle of the birthing process, or it's the midwives of Yahweh. You see that? The two midwives. By the way, the word midwife, that comes from the word yilad, which means to bring something forth, to make it be born, to beget. It indicates to declare one's pedigree. Who's your baby's daddy? The word shifra, it means brightness. Brightness as in the sense of a sound, a bright, clear sound, like from a shofar, which would be, we'd have a short, pregnant pause, and someone with a shofar could blow that. It's connected, that word shofar, shifra, is connected with adorning the heavens with the stars. And it's interesting because shifra was literally the shofar. There's that pregnant pause again. There you go. Clear, concise. Look at it. Sheen, pay, resh, hay. The sheen represents El Shaddai, consume, to destroy, because it represents fire. Then you have the Hebrew letter pay, the mouth, to speak. You have the word resh, meaning hey, the head, the beginning. The Hebrew letter hey, and it came in Revelation. El Shaddai is a consuming one. At his mouth or his word is the beginning of Revelation. Her name is the same as that word shofar with the hey appended to the end of it. And so it's indicating that this word Shifra was the voice of revelation or the voice of Yahweh for the children of Israel. I contend this woman and her counterpart, Pua, taught the Torah to the children of Israel. The word Pua, you can see it in the notes. It indicates, if you look in the letters, the voice of the humble one is the well or fountain of revelation. That's what it's talking about. That's what you should be. You should be the voice of the humble one who brings forth the word of Yahweh. They were witnesses in Egypt. These midwives were the ones that were responsible for bringing forth the genealogy, the pure pedigree, the DNA, the seed, the word of Yahweh. They taught the Torah. And if you look at it, you'll find that word Shifra only used one other time, and it's in Job chapter 26, where it says, by his ruach has he garnished his Shifra, he spoke into the heavens, and his hand formed the crooked serpent. Torah was written in the stars. And now you understand that word the Zephardia or Zippor, like in Zipporah. You ever wondered why Moshe left Zipporah? It was because Zipporah was teaching things contrary to the Torah of Yahweh, and he put it away. So what you find here is that there's an indictment against people that are usurping the authority of Yahweh and beginning to teach their own doctrine as if it was copied from the book in the face of the priest, when in fact it's a form of idolatry. I don't care what your opinions are. If you can't find it substantiated in the Torah, not taken out of context, within the mouth of two witnesses at least, then there's something wrong with your doctrine and dogma. Can y'all hold on a little while? This parsha occurs in the sixth month, the month of the Lord. It's not an accident. How many of you know the seventh month is when we're going to celebrate Sukkot? Elul is the month of repentance. You can find it in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 6, verse 15. It's usually translated, and I believe it's wrongly translated, as meaning nothingness. If you really go back and do a proper research, you'll find that it actually indicates to search. This is the season of searching. The month of Elul, the first day of the month of Elul, was when Yeshua was driven into the wilderness. He spent the 30 days of the month of Elul in the wilderness, plus an additional 10, for a total of 40 days in the wilderness. He comes out on that 10th day, which was the 10th day of the 7th month. It happens that the 10th day of the 7th month was the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement was when not only could we go in to the holy place, but it was also the day when the Jubilee season would be announced. Amen? You see that in my notes there. It came out on the day of, known as Yom Kippur, it would have been the 80th Jubilee season, and he begins to quote from Isaiah 61. And what he does when he quotes from Isaiah 61, you can see it there in Luke chapter 4 as well. It's very well known because he says, the Spirit of Yahweh is upon me. Listen to me, because the same Spirit is supposed to be on you. Yeshua begins to righteously judge. That's when his ministry begins right there. And he begins to judge, heal, deliver, bring sight, bring liberty. And that's the purpose of righteous judgment. Your words are to judge properly. Your words are to bring healing. Your words are to deliver. Your words are to bring sight. And your words are to bring liberty. That's the purpose of righteous judgment. Can you say amen? I thought it was kind of ironic that he says that he was sent to set at liberty those that were bruised. Even in the Greek language, you can trace it all the way back, it has the same meaning as that word shuth. Words are there to set you free from the captive. Now listen to this. The month of the Lord is the month that's associated with the end of our exile, because we come out of captivity in the sixth month and we go into the seventh month where we have our Jubilee season with the king, our husband. But it's interesting, the Lord and exile are connected, and exile is a penalty for unintentional murder. Did you hear me? Now I want you to think about it. Because we've acknowledged that death and life are in the power of the tongue, right? Is it possible that we've been in exile because we've been prone to murdering other individuals with our tongue? Is it possible that we've been spreading death in our own circumstances because of what's been coming out of our mouths? An evil tongue is a tongue that's judged as having placed a hand on someone to murder them. Hello? Are you still there? Accidental murder is a different thing. When someone in a passion or a heat of rage would be overcome, we understand things happen. What do? A righteous judgment gives you an opportunity to cleanse yourself from where you made mistakes. And Yahweh made a provision even for these kinds of situations, and He placed them in cities called cities of refuge. See that? The guilty were exiled to the cities of refuge. Here's what happens. If you've been guilty, if your tongue has been a tool, a sword that you've used to do harm to other individuals, you can go to the city of refuge. The interesting thing is that the city of refuge belonged to the Levites. And it was said that the Levites wrote and lived and taught the Torah. What a remedy for an unruly tongue. If you've been having problems with your tongue, if you know that your circumstances is one that is warranted because of what's been coming out of your mouth, flee to a place of refuge, which is the Torah of Yahweh's word, and it's stated you can be vindicated. It's stated you can be saved. You can see my right hand. I need healing in my body. I need healing in my body. I need healing in my family. I need to see some things happen in my own life. And I'm declaring the word of Yahweh accordingly. I'm not going to accept anything less than that. I'm going to make that declaration, even if I have to do like Job said, even if He kills me, I'm going to go out of here praising His name. And His word's going to be on my mouth and on my tongue. I'm not going to allow any people to say what I have to say. The rabbis teach that there were signs that pointed to people to the cities of refuge. And all those signs were two words. One word actually repeated twice. Miklat, miklat. Refuge. Refuge. And if you break it down in the Hebrew language, the gematria of the word miklat is 179. If you do the math, 179 twice is 358. That's the numeric value of the word Messiah. The place of refuge is the place where the Messiah dwells. It's where His word's at. The person who was exiled to the city of refuge to be set free from there, he could only be set free one way, and it was when the high priest who was in charge at that time died. And I thought, isn't that like Messiah? You and I we're in the city of refuge. We were exiled because of this unruly tongue. Your tongue keeps you from having a relationship with Yahweh. But the high priest died so that you could be set free. And I thought, that's kind of amazing, because if you go back and look, Adam was the first one who experienced exile. And he was exiled because he rejected the word of Yahweh. And thus, Adam inadvertently became responsible for the death of all men. For by one man's sin, death passed unto all men. Adam became the first exile that was supposed to flee to the city of refuge. And you look in Genesis chapter 3, the Lamb, the Messiah, the high priest, had to die in his place. Adam then was set up in the earth as the first judge in the stead of the high priest. But he also was the first idolater. He was the first one that worshipped the Asherah tree, that tree of carnal knowledge. And he passed that legacy down to you and I. And what you and I have got to do, we have got to break the generational curses. And if you want the generational curses broken off of you, if you want to get out of that rut where you've been so caught up with that carnal knowledge that the enemy has been supplying you with and has been grandfathered down to you and has kept you in bondage since it's been spoken over you, you can say, I have this physical malady. There's no healing for me. This was something that was given to my children. You can't escape it. This is part of the legacy that was passed down to my family. My family have had problems with their nerves. My family have had addiction problems and alcoholic abuse and all sorts of things. You can say, that's part of my heritage. Or you can say, no, that man died.
That's right.
And there's something different. During the month of Elul, it's customary to blow the shofar. During the month of Elul, it's customary to blow the shofar. Isn't that amazing? You blow it each day until the seventh month begins. Listen to this. The shofar represents the voice of Yahweh, and it represents your voice. He's calling for repentance. And it's you, a picture of you confessing that you've decided to repent, and you're going to make some declarations as you blow the word of Yahweh. You're going to declare His word in your life. The book of Psalms is read during the month of Elul, with particular focus on the 27th Psalm. And I want you to note verse 13. It says, in the English, I had fainted, unless I had believed to see the goodness of Yahweh in the land of the living. And if you will notice, right there, top right-hand corner, when you see the Hebrew words, Lamed Vav, Lamed Aleph, isn't that amazing? It's the word Elul written backwards. It's in this month that Yahweh is going to set His captive free. And if you will allow me, I'm going to finish reading Psalm 27. I'd like to ask you to stand with me. And I want you to look at this screen. And I believe that today the confession of your mouth can change as you roll up to the next slide. And I want you to read this with me. And I want you to just listen to these words. And before you do it, I want you to understand. You've been going through some hard times. How many of you have had problems in your physical body? It's okay to raise your hand. You want to be set free. How many of you have other issues in your life? Maybe you've been battling fear and depression. Maybe there's some of your family members, your wife, your husband, your children. Maybe there's something going on in your job. I think that every one of us could fall into one of these categories. And if you understand what's being said here, the Lord, Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yahweh is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired, Yahweh, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of Yah all the days of my life, so that I can behold the beauty of Yah, to inquire in His temple. For in the time of trouble, He'll hide me in His pavilion. In the secret of His tabernacle shall He hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. And now shall mine head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in His tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises unto Yah. Hear, O Yah, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, seek my face, my heart said unto you, your face will I seek. Hide not your face far from me. Put not your servant away in anger. You've been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O Yah, of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then Yah will take me up. Teach me your way, O Yah, and lead me the plain path because of my enemies. Deliver me not unto the will of my enemies. For false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. I have fainted, unless I had believed to see the goodness of Yah in the hand of the living. And I want you to read this with me. Wait on the Lord. Say it with me. Wait on God, Lord. Be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on Yahweh. Can you say amen there? Friends, I submit this restoration of Yahweh's word, His Torah that ends our exile, and it's restoring righteous judgment in the earth. Did you know that your exile includes having an absence of health, absence from peace, absence from the things that Yahweh's made a promise that He would restore? And if you've been in exile in either of those places, then today's the day for you to be set free. If you're willing, can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. I want to finish with a priestly benediction. If I could just get you to take hold of the hand of an individual beside you. And I believe that this declaration is going to have an impact on your life. I believe that Yahweh wants you to be set free. I believe He wants you speaking His word. May Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yahweh make His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Yahweh lift up His countenance upon you and give you shalom. Ya'er Yahweh Panaboleka Vichaneka Isa Yahweh Panaboleka Vishomaka Shalom. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Give him a praise.